So my name is Pamela Graham, and I've been serving as part of Columbia's Web Collection Steering Committee, which has been a really exciting and interesting task, and I'm happy to be moderating this next session. In our keynote, Jim Neal referred to the importance of collaboration and how the task of Born Digital preservation was much too big of a task for any one institution or library to tackle single-handedly. And so this next session focuses on collaborative models, and we have a few different cases that we can share with you so that we can all hear more about how work has been advancing in this area. I'm just going to give quickly the names of the panelists, but we'll ask each of them to provide any additional background information about their work as appropriate. Each presentation will take about 20 minutes, and we'll have questions after each, as we did in the first session. So we have, I'll just introduce people as they go across. Anna Parici, who is here working at Columbia University Libraries, Deborah Kemp, Sumitra Duncan, and Lily Prejil, and then at the far end, Alex Thurman, who is at Columbia. And we have the three presenters in the middle are all part of the NYARC, New York Art Resources Consortium, sandwiched by the two Columbia people on either end. But the order of presentations will be as it is in the program, with NYARC starting, followed by Anna, and then Alex. So with that, I'll turn things over to our NYARC colleagues. Thanks.
Great. Thank you so much, Pamela and Bob and everyone at Columbia for inviting us to be here today. We're really happy to be part of this day. And I also just want to say how much I enjoyed that previous panel. I mean, don't you love solutions? And I like APIs, too. So I'm Deborah Kemp, and I'm the principal investigator of a two-year grant from the Mellon Foundation that is allowing the New York Art Resources Consortium to build a program for collecting web-based art historical materials for research and for documentation. Together with my colleagues Sumitra Duncan and Lily Prejil, I'll share the journey of our road to web archives, touching on the special nature of web-based art resources and the solutions we've come up with thus far. Some of you in the room I know are familiar with NYARC, but for those of you who aren't, we are three libraries of leading art museums here in New York City. And we've been working together since 2006 to achieve efficiencies and economies of scale. The Brooklyn Museum, the Frick Art Reference Library, the Frick Collection, where I'm based, and the MoMA Library. That we are where we are today, with perhaps the most ambitious art-based web archive in the US, is most likely a result of the successful collaborations we've had in the past. With lots of encouragement from Jim Neal, Mr. Radical Collaboration himself, I guess we could call him our spiritual advisor, NYARC has secured a series of grants from the Mellon Foundation that have given us years of support to develop shared catalogs and services, and we have a strong bond of commitment to maintaining those programs. Thanks to our shared catalog, our researchers have access to millions of analog and online specialized materials across the three libraries. We have always been about ephemera, or at least that is which is commonly termed ephemera by the larger library community. To us, much of the flotsam and jetsam of the art world is the key to true discovery and knowledge. Our thousands of users, who are most certainly our museum staff, but also range far beyond that, from prominent to amateur scholars, to historians, journalists, and economists of all stripes, and of course, people in the business of art. No one is unaware that art is big business these days. An astonishingly large quantity of our holdings are unique. This fact was verified by an overlap study done by OCLC in 2008, that estimated 40% some uniqueness of NYARC holdings when compared with WorldCat. I would say that our continuous lack of duplication in HathiTrust collections also demonstrates this. When researchers come into our libraries, they can find historical minutia because of our mission to collect and thoroughly describe items that have been ignored by other libraries. We have obscure artist mags and manifesti. We have annotated auction catalogs that go back to the 17th century. We have tiny two-page checklists of exhibitions where you can find the first time an artist appears on the scene. We have millions of photographs from galleries, auction houses, and private collections that document provenance and prices of artworks. We have rare views of installations in galleries and museums, along with extensive archives of the art scene in New York, the US, and beyond. We've also taken pride in documenting the ongoing efforts to repatriate looted art from World War II and other injustices. From this assembled trove, discoveries and connections are made. But what to do when this very sort of information exists nowhere else but on the web? As we began to feel the digital shift in art move to the internet, granted it's been slower than say, law libraries, but at this point it's pretty much the air we all breathe, we were stymied. How could we possibly begin to capture and ensure that this same sort of documentation will be there for researchers in the future? At this point, I think there is at least a basic understanding by the public of the instability of everything on the net. Thanks to some great sound bites from The New Yorker and Vint Cerf, for which we are most grateful. But when we decided to take action a few years back, there was considerably less comprehension by the art community of what web archiving might be for or how it could be used. And that's where the NIARC collaboration gave us a leg up. The Mellon Foundation was once again supportive. They heard our plea that art information has its own distinct set of challenges which set it apart, and that smaller, specialized libraries have a unique role to play, such as NIARC's library's shared mission to serve art historical research. A planning grant allowed us to talk to constituents and make a logical roadmap for moving forward. The conclusion of that grant was to concentrate on what's important to scholars, what would be most subject to loss, and most crucially, to find an incremental way to do it. And incremental it has been. We started with five broad categories to collect that we gleaned from focus groups and consultants, and ever since, we have faced obstacles that entailed cutting back in some form. First up were the websites of the three NIARC institutions, that is the museums of MoMA, Brooklyn, and the Frick, a vast quantity right there, plus the NIARC website. It only seemed prudent to cover our own output first and foremost. Added to that were catalogue raisonné, which are the basic DNA of art history and always subject to revision, auction houses, websites created by artists themselves or devoted to a particular artist, galleries and dealers, and other websites that we had already chosen to highlight through records with URL links to current sites in our online catalog. We later found that we needed to refine the focus somewhat in every case. That said, as we approached the end of our grant at the end of this year, we are closing in our goal to capture 2 terabytes of works in these areas of focus that you see here on the screen. We now have more than 100 seeds distributed into 10 collections in Archivit. With any long and ambitious journey, there are peaks and valleys. Some days we feel triumph, and certainly others, defeat. For example, capturing auction transactions has been a primary of interest since we started, but we now realize that the aggregated databases increasingly used by auction houses are proving nigh impossible to capture. Much of the history of these transactions has already disappeared from the web. All of this painfully gained knowledge serves to amplify our certainty that the only way to harness important collections is through broader collaboration and big time, out beyond our usual horizons. This diagram is just the first pass through a larger net of partners that our grant has provided. I would say there's at least one other ever-expanding cast of associations that our project has led to, some expected and some not. So with this in mind, I think it's a good place for my colleagues to tell you about the outcomes from some of these partnerships.
Thank you, Debbie. Good morning, everyone. I'm Sumitra Duncan, NIARC's Web Archiving Program Coordinator. So I'll be providing a brief overview of the ongoing administration of NIARC's Web Archiving Program, project staffing, work with our vendor partners, and our quality assurance activities. As Debbie demonstrated with this diagram, our web archiving activities have been, from the beginning, quite collaborative and creative, inclusive of our project staffing. My position as coordinator is funded for 2 years by NIARC's Mellon Grant, and we additionally have 3 part-time interns who are funded by this grant. Each of those interns is based at a NIARC library, and they focus their efforts on archiving a NIARC institutional website. NIARC has also partnered with the Pratt Institute School of Information and Library Science program in hosting 3 IMLS-funded interns at the Frick Art Reference Library over this past academic year. Each of them is also focused on conducting quality assurance for our web archive collections. We were quite fortunate to be selected as a host institution for the first round of the National Digital Stewardship Residency Program in New York City. NDSR resident Carl Rainer Blumenthal joined our project staff for a 9-month period to focus efforts on best practices for quality assurance, preservation metadata, and long-term storage recommendations for our collections. Carl has just completed his residency with NIARC this past week, and his documentation has been made available online for greater accessibility within the web archiving and digital preservation community. We additionally collaborate with several consultants on this grant, publishers of Born Digital scholarly materials, and we rely on the support of the existing NIARC staff and technical services. Archivit is our primary vendor partner. We utilize their subscription-based service to conduct crawls of our seeds, manage our collections, conduct quality assurance of our captured website. Archivit proved to be a highly collaborative partner to us from the very beginning, and we've fostered a dialogue with them on possible avenues to take and our objectives of building out collaborative collection development tools for shared use in the community. NIARC's NDSR resident and I myself formed the New York Area Archivit Users Group this past winter, and we'll be holding our next meeting this summer in July in conjunction with the Metropolitan New York Library Council's Web Archiving Special Interest Group, which Anna and I started this year as well. We also work with another vendor called Hanzo Archives. They are a corporate provider of web archiving services. Through Hanzo Archives, we can execute on-demand captures of sites that we found particularly challenging to adequately crawl ourselves in using the Archivit tool, such as the example here, which is a dynamic MoMA exhibition site called Inventing Abstraction. Within this slide, you'll see there are a lot of different relationships, and when you're interacting with the site, each relationship that's embedded comes out, and we found this one particularly challenging. Hanzo was able to capture it, and we are working to integrate that into our archivic collections. Here's another example, the artist website of Wangechi Mutu. We had a bit of trouble capturing this one as well. As you'll see, the homepage here is an animation that opens up as the page loads. And at first, we were not able to capture that with Archivit. The visual aspects of this homepage versus textual data that we could glean from it in playback are particularly important, and I think this demonstrates the need for sufficient ability to capture dynamic content inherent to these art-related websites. It's crucial that we're able to capture the equally significant elements of visual appearance, functionality and behavior, and textual data for visual arts. Built into our grant were funds to work with our 2 web archiving vendor partners to engineer an integration between the Hanzo works into our Archivit account, so that the files could be played back alongside our other archived sites. We've been pleased with the technology offered by Hanzo, but guaranteeing that a budget and an appropriate pricing structure to continue to utilize that commercial service merits further discussion for us. This diagram represents the main components of our workflow as they've evolved over the grant period thus far. We've thus far adhered to a formalized permissions process for partnering with publishers and site creators to harvest their sites, include them in our collections. And our permissions model was largely based on that of our partners within the web archiving community, namely Columbia University, who've shared their experience with us in using a permissions-based approach. We've received a great deal of positive feedback from many of the site owners and publishers that we've approached to be our partners. However, response rates certainly remain an issue, and we're now pursuing additional fair use captures via a notification model in order to scale moving forward. While each of the components of managing our web archiving program are ongoing, we've recently concentrated much of our efforts into the areas of quality assurance and description and access. These are screenshots of the Museum of Modern Art homepage, which we're crawling on a quarterly basis and we're actively QAing. Our curated and QA'd crawl is on the right, and a general wayback capture is on the left, incorporating the human intervention of adjusting the scope and conducting tedious levels of QA by our intern technicians has proved to be crucial to capturing even our own institutional websites, as you can see. But as you'll see in this example, conducting manual QA to a site such as MoMA's Kiki Smith exhibition site is simply not sustainable with certain dynamic content, especially with flash files that require triggering and time-based processes. Manual intervention via hundreds of patch crawls over weeks has not found itself to be sustainable for us. It requires a lot of time and a lot of patience, and while we've made some great progress in streamlining our QA workflow, conducting QA to this degree remains a challenge to our level of staffing without having tools for greater automation. So we're forced to make decisions and determine how much is good enough. As our QA practices intensified over the past year, we developed a QA reporting form to track our progress and centralize our activities. This streamlining has been beneficial to our practice, not only from a project management standpoint, but also in allowing for ease of identification of common QA issues across our sites, and hopefully a duplication of QA efforts from our project staff and on the part of archive and engineering and support staff. And this is thanks to the efforts of our NDSR resident Carl, and we've made our program-specific QA documentation available to the community via the NIARC Wiki, which you can see the link here for that site. We're excited to continue to share this documentation and other documentation related to our workflow as it evolves throughout the program. And I will now turn things over to my colleague, Lily, to discuss access and discovery. Thank you all.
Thanks, Sumitra. Hi, good morning. I'm happy to be here today. Thanks for the invite. I'm Lily Pajil, and I work with the NIARC group as a consortium coordinator and systems manager. I'm also a consultant on the Mellon Web Archiving Grant tasked with implementing a discovery layer to provide a format agnostic search across the NIARC collections. Whether those collections are print, electronic, or web archives. And as you've heard from my colleagues, capturing born digital resources is critical to our mission as memory institutions. And we also believe that preservation and access go hand in hand. And making archive content easily discoverable for researchers is a primary component of our web archiving program. So to facilitate integrated access to our web archive collections and Archive-It, we're using two strategies. The first strategy is to leverage Archive-It's full text indexing in a unified discovery environment. And the second is to create bibliographic records for structured access to seeds in our collection. In crafting our proposal to Mellon, we were very conscious that we would be creating another silo of content with our web archives, and we didn't want to handicap researchers from being able to actively use or find those collections. Our primary access point to NIARC's collective collections is now our Millennium System OPAC, which we call Arcade. And there's a screenshot at the top of the screen here. As you know, Archive-It has their own interface to access captured content, and we knew that we needed a discovery system to unite the two. During our planning grant, we began to assess the discovery platforms with the primary functional requirement being the ability to unite our Archive-It collection into a single search experience. While it seems naive now, at the time, it was a bit shocking to learn that web archives were not on any of our vendors' radars. So we pressed the vendors to demonstrate how they would incorporate Archive-It full-text search results into their discovery products by requiring a proof of concept. And in the end, we only received two proof of concepts, one from a company called Deep Web Technologies and another from Ex Libris. We ultimately selected Ex Libris's Primo discovery solution, and I'm now actively implementing it. I'm happy to share the screenshot of the early version of our Primo installation with you today to illustrate the Archive-It integration. My caveat to all of you in looking at this is that the front end is still very much under construction, and things like labels and icons have yet to be refined. But what you can see here is how the web archive collection results are presented in the Primo result list. Here you can see I've run a search on the artist Osamu Noguchi, and by ticking a checkbox on the right side of the screen, it's going to expand my search to include Archive-It results. These results are presented alongside entries for books and journal articles, integrating the results into a single result list. The archive it results include a title, a text snippet, and a link back to the captured content. So just teasing this out a little bit more, if you click, I've pulled out one of the results for the catalog resume for Osamu Deguchi, and when you click on the result in the Primo display, it brings the user to the archive page in our archive it account. And so how is this happening? We're using an API, so I'm very happy to be leveraging Archive-It's open search API to dynamically display the results. And if you want to learn more about the open search API, there's a link at the top of the screen. I should note that Primo is not doing any manipulation of the ranking of the Archive-It results as far as, and there's no special Primo magic happening here. We're just using Primo as the engine for which to display the results provided back by the API. As far as we know, this will be the first implementation of the Archive-It API in Primo. We're relatively certain of this because there was a technical barrier that needed to be overcome to allow the two systems to exchange data. And we're very grateful for both Ex Libris and Archive-It for coming together at our request to solve the issue. The fix that was put into place will benefit the larger community, as it means that any library using both Archive-It and Primo can now make use of the API. And if anyone's interested in more details about how to integrate the API into Primo, I'd be happy to share them. So while making use of the full text searching is one approach, it doesn't provide the precision of searching structured metadata. The creation of bibliographic records for our captured content is also an important and necessary part of our workflow. We've decided to create seed-level records using the MARC format to contribute records to WorldCat, which follows our procedure for analog materials. The scalability of this approach is not lost on us, especially when thinking about embedded documents that warrant their own bibliographic description. However, we think this model best supports discovery and established networks and could potentially be expanded as a cooperative activity within the art library's community. That said, we are very interested in maximizing efficiency and streamlining metadata creation. And to that end, we're now working on recommendations for OCLC to improve upon their extract metadata tool, which provides a starter MARC record from a URL. So here you'll see a screenshot for the Osamu Noguchi catalog resume record in WorldCat. And you'll notice that the records contain two links, one for the current site and one for the archive site. And this follows practice that we've seen at Columbia, which points back to our Archive-It collection. That same record will be imported into Arcade, our local catalog. And then it'll be pushed to Primo, providing multiple access points for our web archive collection in local systems and on the network level. We're aiming to be promiscuous with our metadata, but we would like to see better tools repurposing metadata across these systems. The formation of these records, which fields to include how to describe the archived aspect of these resources, has been a task taken up by our consultant on the project, Rebecca Gunther. And Rebecca is here with us today, and I'm sure she'd be happy to field some questions regarding our metadata practices. Over the past few months, she's been engaging NIARC catalogers and partners, including staff here at Columbia and the research group at OCLC, to help develop this metadata profile for describing web archives. Here's just a screenshot of one page of that profile, which shows you the MARC field 583 action note, and that profile is now in its final drafting stages. We anticipate posting it to our wiki, the same wiki that Sumitra had showed you a screenshot of, very soon for both comment and consultation, and we hope it'll be used to the broader web archiving community. So all of this leads to playing a bit of catch up with record creation for the 100 plus seeds that already exist in our collection, and anticipating the launch of Primo this summer, which will be followed by rigorous user testing and continued development to make sure that users truly understand what they're getting when they see web archive results. And while I've covered some specifics of our discovery roadmap, more broadly, we aim to continue to advocate for cooperation between vendors and interoperability between systems, collaborate with all of you to improve the discovery of web archives, and engage users to better understand how to integrate this content into their research practices. I'll pass it back to Debbie for final thoughts.
So just a few thoughts of next steps. So while we've come a long way, our journey thus far has only made it acutely clear that new approaches are also badly needed. So what are the next steps that we'd like to see this group gathered here today help bring along? While all of the goals we've established for the NIARC collections are no doubt the aims of any web archive, and we will all benefit from tools that can help us build at scale. On an even broader horizon, it's crucial to work together to avoid disjointed and unused collections. Well-integrated collections at a network level must be created. Those can logically happen with our peer institutions, but we really need to reach beyond our usual comfort levels for it to become a reality. Included in a wish list are collection building tools, methods of automating QA and metadata, and better integration of crawls and collections. We can't reasonably expect Wayback Machine to continue to be the gospel and Brewster Kahle the redeemer of our collective heritage. As just to echo Jim, federal, national, and global initiatives are badly needed for high-level programs of collections, preservation, copyright reform, and federal depository requirements for EPUBs. And finally, we haven't forgotten the use of web archives. We need models to promote and measure the scholarly impact of this vast trove in order to make more informed choices going forward. We at NIARC believe this can happen to some degree, and we're determined to remain part of the engine for change. After all, what is the alternative? So thank you.
So we have a few minutes now for some questions, if anyone has any for our speakers.
Yeah, I've been thinking a lot about the granularity of discovery. Maybe this is a question for Lily. With regard to, obviously there's a scalability question here, but there are objects within websites that, depending on who you're talking to, might warrant separate bibliographic description in a standard way. So the obvious examples would be relatively stable chunks of stuff like PDF documents and reports, which, you know, would be collected as standalone objects and which may be discoverable via keyword searching in your keyword interface. But I'm just wondering about what you've thought about how to promote the visibility and discoverability of those objects in and of themselves.
Sure. Can you hear me okay? I think any one of us could answer this question because we've talked about this at length in the NIARC group about how we tackle this question of embedded documents. And we have PDF documents, but we have all kinds of other types of documents as well. And I think, you know, we're looking for an approach to be able to describe some of those documents. And I think we'll use a curation approach the same that we do with our collections in terms of identifying documents and providing bibliographic description for some of those documents to give the same level of access that we do with our analog materials. But it is a scalability question for sure. And I don't know, Debbie, if you have more to.
And you know, they are distinct items as well. So I think we were trying to lump everything together and realize that we do have to parse them out a little bit more. And we're trying to think creatively about how to do that in a manageable way while we still continue to collect print and plenty of it. So we're looking to the Wayback Machine to maybe just do quick captures, and then perhaps there are ways of integrating those into our archive collections too, because they don't necessarily need to be repeatedly crawled. So
and we're actually finding that some of the things that we would want to capture are already captured in the Wayback Machine.
Yeah, that was what it's like, oh yeah, it's already there.
So they're already there. So we would create a bibliographic record pointing to that capture.
And there could be fast track ways of doing that, mm-hmm. I think.
Follow up on that one. One of the other things is the idea of going after those items as born digital records themselves separately, then thinking of them as just things on a website, and then working out how you then link back around to where they may actually be archived themselves. So you're not worrying about the issue of it's just the PDF that's online, but in fact you're actually getting that original formatted document from those creators themselves. It's one of the things where, you know, we're trying to look at how do you parse that. Is it content on a website, or is it actually website content? Mm-hmm. That is dynamic, that is created specifically for the web, or is it just a delivery platform? And so looking at the, you know, how do you go further with the producers of those sites to say, let's actually take your content in, but if that's not your business because you're looking at web archiving, you know, who's actually dealing with those born digital records themselves, if they're even being thought of in that way, where you can then have preservable copies through time.
Yeah, you're right, and of course context is part of what you're trying to create too. But it's spurred some good conversations with content creators, and it's just, as Bob said, where does it all fit in the library context? Yeah, we're still sorting that out.
Yeah, my turn. Okay. One of the great pleasures of watching people from art museums give presentations is the art in the presentations. So thank you for that. We've spent quite a lot of resources dealing with HTML5 and JavaScript and AJAX, and I'm very taken by the fact that you seem to have an approach through Hanzo of capturing some of that programmatically displayed content. And it was a Mellon grant, so I wonder, is that software now available for us to leverage?
We need your leverage to help get it there, I think. You know, it's been... Hanzo is a commercial company, and their services are priced accordingly. But we've had really good rapport with them, and sorting through, you know, making decisions about what would be financially valuable for us. Certainly, I think starting with our own institutional websites made that a little bit easier, because that's, of course, quite important. And we were really fortunate to have the opportunity to capture this. I mean, MoMA is getting ready to do a huge switch of its website, and if we hadn't done this, I would say that stuff wouldn't be there. So it is priced accordingly, though, and so I think, though, our success demonstrates that it's worth continuing this conversation, you know, with Hanzo and perhaps other markets. There could be something more scaled to our needs, you know, if there's leverage there.
I think in the interest of time, we should probably move on to the next presenter, but if there's some time toward the end, maybe we can field some more questions related to this first presentation. So with that, let me introduce Anna Parici.
So, hi everyone. I think everyone has heard my name many times today, but this has been a big project for us to bring people together, and we're really glad to see all of you here today. So, I will get started, and that was what I just said. And I also to do a quick shout out to Bob, Alex, Naima, Kate Birch, Kate Harcourt, Bill Hamilton, Ryan Graham, and Pat White and Nini Larkin, who aren't, Pat and Nini aren't in this room, but lunch is, you know, they're doing, and many other logistics are they're doing. So the grant that funds my position, it's the Web Resources Archive and Collaboration. It's a Mellon-funded project, and we are very grateful to the Mellon Foundation for supporting this work. It came out of the grant was inspired by a summit here at Columbia. Some of you were there. And what was determined was collaboration was needed, more collaboration. You know, we also heard Jim Neal, who is our university librarian, you know, his vision for this, and this is part of that. So the collaborations we were focusing on were the web archiving community/communities, including the incentive awards winners, who you're hearing from today, other research libraries, so that takes the form of the Borrow Direct and Ivy Plus collaborations, which I'll be talking about most today, users and potential users of web archives, especially with PAMLA. We've been working on a citation analysis and user interviews to get richer use cases, and website creators, so direct outreach to those making websites at Columbia, also creating best practices for site creators to have a very wide reach. So this is a quick history of the Mellon funding for Columbia for web archiving. There was a you know, capacity assessment. There was the Human Rights Web Archive built through the last grant, and then there is this one. So I think I covered a lot of this, actually, before even getting to this slide. But the incentive awards grants were part of this, citation analysis, as a couple quick words about it. We're dealing with 1,900 URLs from six major journals focusing on human rights scholarship in 2010. And we've had a human, including Naima, test these URLs and another graduate assistant. And we found that about 46% of them don't work. They don't go to the cited content. And then we say, well, now what? And we leverage APIs in some cases to see if that content is in the Internet Archive and the Human Rights Web Archive, which has been built through the last grant. As I mentioned, Pamela is doing interviews so we can enrich use case development, outreach, and here we go with the Bar Direct and Ivy Plus. So I will probably switch back and forth between the terms Ivy Plus and Bar Direct. Both of them mean the same thing for the purposes of this presentation. There is one member who is part of Ivy Plus but not part of Bar Direct, and unfortunately I'm just not dealing with that today. So we've got, I think, members from most of these institutions in this room. I was doing a quick count, and I think about 25% of the people in this room I am going to thank at some point in this presentation, because we've had such a wide variety of participants in the collections. So I'm not gonna read this out, we'll save that time. But here's a little map of our Ivy Plus partners. Here is a logo for BorrowDirect, and I mentioned that the software as a service we use to build the collections is Archivit. And I am going to ask you to indulge me a little bit for some comparisons. We had a terrible winter, especially in New England, where I live. I telecommute a large portion of my time. So we got 76 or so inches of snow this year, and Lily, who telecommutes from Boston, got even more. So we're going to compare web archiving to gardening on a modest scale. So we've got our seeds and we've got our seeds. So after that terrible winter, let's focus on, you know, growth and what we can do with modest means. You know, not terribly modest, but they are limited like any other program. So as I said, collaborative web archiving projects, they're being supported and furthered by existing groups, these cohorts of peers, including the Ivy's Plus Art and Architecture group and the Borough Direct Music Librarians group. So you know who you are, thank you. And the collaborative collection development that those groups are doing already have kind of more, I don't wanna say morphed, but they've given the basis for these collaborative collections that have been built. About those collaborative collections, we've got the Contemporary Composers Web Archive, and we had 11 participating curators. So far, we have 56 sites available through Archivit with MARC records made by Russell Merritt. And you know, just some basic stats on how big it is, done some outreach. One other thing I'd like to just highlight is the quality assurance testing done by Naima, as well as the music librarians and the Borrow Direct group. It was really amazing to have their input to see what they thought was important in terms of what's represented. So by contemporary composers, our working definition for now is contemporary composers who are still living or were deceased after 1950. And our priorities, what bumped people to the top were they were either faculty, but more often, it was because they were their scores were collected by six or more Borrow Direct institutions. The Borrow Direct music librarians are working on collaborative collecting, so there's less duplication in scores and a richer, more wide variety represented. And the second collection is the Collaborative Architecture, Urbanism, and Sustainability Web Archive. We had at least a start nine curators from Ivy Plus institutions who sent up to 20 seeds per institution. This is a little bit about how big it is. And over 80 of those sites are available in Archivit right now, and over 60 of them have MARC records, thanks to Alex Thurman, who you'll hear from later about another project. So Causeway's themes are urban fabric, public space, and community activism, and each librarian made nominations focused on the geographic region in which her or his institution is located. We also did a very pilot collection about climate change, and that wasn't revolving around an existing group of peers, but we got 156 seeds nominated by at least 27 selectors at six institutions. I say at least 27 because some of them were committees and I'm not sure how many people were on them, but we had a wide variety of disciplines represented and a lot of enthusiasm for this topic. We haven't harvested these seeds, we're more analyzing what they are and who they came from and what we can learn from that. So I'm just gonna pretty much race through these slides because these are, you know, the foundational elements of web archiving for the purposes of Columbia and the collaborative projects. And I just wanted to represent this information quickly in our slides that, you know, I'll post. So you have a sense of what we really feel is important and what we communicate to our stakeholders. At the very end, you'll see the Web Archives world tour of all the places I've been doing presentations to try to get us talking more about web archiving and building networks around it. So the main elements are selection, collection, metadata assignment and cataloging, quality assurance, access, and long-term stewardship. And another part of this process is asking for permission, and so far we ask for permission of all site owners before harvesting their collections, which is labor-intensive, but so far has met a lot of really enthusiastic responses, and I think has been a really good place to start. So Jim mentioned, you know, the curation part of this, the collecting, getting the content, and again, we're relying on the subject expertise of the selectors. And we also early on, you know, worked on this collection development policy. It wasn't quite as ad hoc as a lot of web archives develop as just by necessity. So another thing, you know, as I mentioned, we're using Archivit as our software as a service for harvesting as well as access. And it's really hard to make it look interesting. So also just to mention cataloging and quality assurance, I've named our catalogers, many of them. Others have been involved. They will be mentioned on a slide later on. But you know, as we've been talking about, access is so key to this, and how do users find these resources? Well, we're hoping that they're going to find them through the library catalog as well as through Archivit. And quality assurance testing, as we've mentioned, it's essential. And Carl and Nyark's QA documentation, I think, really gives people access to some of the secrets or not so secret, you know, processes for improving your crawls and going back and troubleshooting and doing patch crawls. So I keep talking about cataloging expertise, and true story, my job is located in original and special materials cataloging, and that's not an accident. It's partially Bob's fault. But I'm gonna talk a little bit about the cataloging records, and I'm just gonna go through it, but I mean, these records are in WorldCat. You can have these records, you at other institutions, via WorldShare. So we are looking for people to help us in technical services to let us know what you need to know about WorldShare to take these records, and we want to give them to you. So in the records themselves, you will have a link to the live site and the archived site. And let's hop on to access here so, you know, I keep the trains moving on time. But again, the questions we ask, who will use these web archives? What are they for? And, you know, recognizing that Archivit is a really good step in terms of an access system, but it's certainly not the be-all, end-all, and thinking about how we can facilitate access through multiple points. And, you know, the elephant in the room that's actually been a pretty well-discussed elephant today is long-term stewardship. And we're starting with getting the content. Okay, well, it's being saved as a work file, which is the preservation standard. We need to take delivery of those work files to some extent or make sure they are securely stored. So There are a couple different ways we could do that. We're still thinking about it. This is still a pilot project, I might remind everyone, so we don't have all the answers yet. Another element of the outreach and something to mention is advocating for curated collections. And, that's part of it. This is where I've been advocating for curated collections when I'm going in person. There have been a lot of remote meetings, but I've been really lucky to be supported by Columbia and other funders to make these trips and talk to people live and in person as well as remotely. These are a few of the presentations and panels. And onward to some of the bigger lessons we've learned through this collaboration. One thing we've learned is collaborative efforts build the project and the new tasks promote professional growth. We've also, as I keep harping on, quality assurance and cataloging are integral to the process of creating high quality collections of web archives. And one of the surprises, maybe not surprises, was distributing work does not necessarily reduce costs. It pays its own dividends, but it isn't an easy division of labor. So the next 6 months, which is about what we have left on this grant, we're working to refine and hopefully make an agreement between the Ivy Plus institutions to share cost, share expertise, share vision in terms of scaling, maintenance, and growth, and shared governance. And another part of my next 6 months is to continue to contribute to professional organizations to strengthen web archiving efforts nationally and internationally. So that's the Internet Preservation, International Internet Preservation Consortium Preservation Working Group. There is the Metro Web Archiving SIG. There's the SAA Web Archiving Roundtable. There is some work going on via ARLIS and so on. So there I have the slide I promised many times. Some of the many people to credit. And so here we have it. And here's where we're going to end the gardening comparison is, talking about our next steps. So we have our seeds, we have our seedlings, and we want them to grow. I'm not going to talk about fertilizer and what we're going to compare it to and we're not going to compare it to, but we are getting to the point where maybe we'll have a nice kelp treatment and, that will help our seedlings come up further. For those of you who garden, if you don't and the kelp thing was confusing, I apologize. So anyway, last thing, actually I guess I lied, we're not totally done with the garden. Grew watermelons last year, was really surprised how small they were when they started, and they ended up being not personal size, but anyway, they turned out to be a pretty good thing to compare web archives to because they have a lot of seeds, and seeds are an integral part of it, but also around that, you get this really rich, juicy fruit, and we're hoping that the web archives are substantial and delicious and nutritious. So anyway, I just made that part up, sorry. Anyway, so thank you for your attention, and please let me know if you have questions or concerns either now or via email or via Twitter. I should have put someone up to asking questions. So, Carl? Okay, thank you.
Anna, can you say anything about parts of the Ivy Plus relationship, distribution of responsibilities or roles that go beyond content curation? Are any of the Ivy Plus partners currently or envisioned as having any other role other than nominating seeds, in other words?
Yeah, that's a good question. So far, Cornell has worked with us on the Composer's Web Archive, the Contemporary Composer's Web Archive records. Russell Merritt was helping a cataloger there better understand the process, and that could be a point for future involvement. Shared cataloging could be something further. I mean, if we were to do item-level description, for example, that would not be scalable, but maybe that could be shared between different institutions. In terms of quality assurance, that's still another space ripe for collaboration. And Naima does a great job, and I also want to know what the music librarians and the architecture librarians notice and think is important, and you know, make sure that's taken into consideration. And I mean, another thing beyond selection at a more administrative level is shared governance and vision for the collections. And you know, if this collaboration goes on, if all of a sudden my four bosses multiplies into 12 or 36 bosses or something like that, the communication between that group, I think, is a huge contribution to the project. Does that help? Okay.
I want to respond a little further to that because we're working this through now, and we, you know, a lot of what Anna's been working on over the last year is trying to explore those questions of what, as she alluded to, what makes sense to distribute and what really needs to be in a core central services. The other aspect of this is that several of the libraries in the Ivies Plus group, let me put it another way, several of the institutions in the Ivies Plus group have some form of web archiving going on already. So, as does Columbia, and we will have continuing a Columbia web archiving program that's distinct from the Ivies Plus one. So one of the things we're also going to be working through over the next year or so is what the relationship is among those things. You know, what's Ivies Plus? What's centralized and coordinated and branded in that way and collectively supported, and how does it interact with independent or semi-independent activities at these different institutions? We don't have the answers yet. We're going to work them through and see how it comes out.
I just had another question about the division of labor going on. You had the different activities laid out in the web archiving. In my experience being the web archive person, you know, I find that there's a lot of blur between those, particularly between capture and Q&A and even selection, because you go into the capture and you're suddenly making appraisal decisions about what is important, what's not important to capture about a site QA. And you're talking about not only having those functions be in different people, but being in different locations, you know, where maybe one person is doing the curation in terms of traditional curation, wanting the materials, someone else is doing the more technical aspects of it. How is that working for you guys?
That's a good question, and that actually kind of leads to a soundbite of collaboration is work. But we have, you know, operated remotely pretty well. I mean, I have a desk at Columbia, but I work from Rhode Island a lot of the time. And most of the collaboration and communications about this is via email. Occasionally there's a phone call. A fair number of times there are presentations. I'll meet with the Ivies Plus Art and Architecture group when they have their biannual meetings. And the music librarians group, I try to meet with them in person or remotely with their biannual meetings. So, you know, I don't have like a blanket answer for the question, but it's a really good point. And I mean, appraisal hasn't really been part of this equation yet. I mean, there are decisions that eventually will have to be made. And then there's also the micro appraisal, right? Of like, is this image essential? Or is this CSS, the lack of the CSS ruining everything? You know, those aren't questions we've really had the time to focus on, but they're really good ones, and they're ones I'd like to talk to you more about, because I know you're doing some work at Johns Hopkins having to do with that. So.
So I had a thought about this question of division of labor and what's scalable and what parts of these collaborative efforts can be, you know, effectively parceled out in different ways. So one of the challenges I mentioned before with regard to the NIARC project has to do with the scalability of providing appropriate bibliographic access to objects, some objects within the websites. Now, we talked about, you know, nominating websites as seeds for themes that were identified in the consortium. So, you know, there was initially human rights, there's the music web, there's the, you know, the climate change and so on. And we had subject librarians, using their own expertise and the value they add through their selectivity to say, well, here's one I would nominate. This is an important one that should be in there. Maybe some of that same means of adding value through selectivity could be applied to identifying the specific objects within the websites that need to get promoted. Maybe not every PDF in every one of those websites needs to get a separate catalog record, but if you think about the metaphor of collecting print books, you know, if I'm a subject selector at Princeton and I buy a book, my cataloging department's going to catalog it. Maybe the parallel to that is if we find a way to automate the mere listing of PDFs, let's just take that as an example of a type. PDFs within the websites that have already been archived as seeds, and then let selectors have at them and say, well, these are the important ones that I would select, in quotes, for my institution. And my institution can go ahead and catalog it in situ, in your archive. And then we've created a record which itself could be shared, obviously, that would enrich the discovery of those objects for everyone. It's just a thought, another level of collaboration through creating a kind of universe of content, like an approval plan, so to speak, or something, of objects within these identified sites that could be promoted for cataloging in a distributed way.
Yeah, I think that's really, that would be a valuable discussion to continue. Thank you.
And, I'll ask Alex to make the long journey over here.
Good afternoon. I'm very happy to see you all here at Columbia. Also tired and hungry, like you are as well. But this is the last hurdle, I think, for all of us. So let's talk about IIPC collaborative collections. So the International Internet Preservation Consortium, or IIPC, was founded in 2003 with 12 participating institutions, including the Internet Archive, the Library of Congress, and 10 national libraries, mostly from European countries, also Canada and Australia. Today, in 2015, there are 49 members, representing a greater geographical and institutional diversity. Now, slightly more than half of member institutions are European, down from 3/4. While national or regional libraries still account for 2/3 of IIPC members. But the IPC now has a growing number of US members, many of which are universities, like most of the institutions represented here today. So it's shifting a little bit. The mission of the IPC, unchanged since the IPC website netpreserve.org went live in 2004, is to acquire, preserve, and make accessible knowledge and information from the internet for future generations everywhere, promoting global exchange and international relations. The primary goal that the IPC has pursued in support of its mission has been to foster the development and use of common tools, techniques, and standards, a goal shared by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation-funded grant project that allowed Columbia University libraries to provide support for the great subawardee projects that we're hearing about today. But the IPC's mission and goals are not limited to tool development, but also embrace collection building and outreach. And to that end, the IIPC has also pursued some collaborative collection development, starting with some event-based collections. So the IIPC's Access Working Group coordinated the efforts of participating curators from several member institutions to identify websites with valuable information about several Olympic Games and their venues, teams, athletes, and fans, beginning with the 2010 Winter Olympics in Vancouver, and continuing through the 2012 Summer Olympics and Paralympics in London. We see the 2012 logo was very controversial, mostly for being ugly, but the four elements in it are digits. You can probably see they're jagged 2012, but a lot of people felt that this was an image of Lisa Simpson playing her saxophone. So we preserved it anyway. And then continuing on to the 2014 Winter Olympics and Paralympics in Sochi, whose logo was celebrated for being the first Olympic logo to include a web address, further evidence of the ascendancy of the web over television, even for sports events. Seed websites, along with some descriptive metadata, were submitted via an online form developed by the University of North Texas, and the Internet Archive provided the crawling of the sites pro bono. Only the 2014 collections were crawled using Archivit specifically and are therefore publicly accessible, but no effort has yet been made to publicize these large, rich collections until all could be made accessible. So at the IPC's annual General Assembly meeting in 2014, held in Paris that year, members were presented with an exciting proposal drafted by Peter Webster and Helen Huck-Yu from the British Library for the IPC Steering Committee. And the idea was that rather than simply relying on the largesse of the Internet Archive for harvesting content for future joint collections, IPC would purchase an Archivit subscription that participating members could use to create new publicly accessible collaborative collections. The proposal was enthusiastically received, with some caveats about the potential legal risks to IPC and its members of creating public web archives. And also it was felt that the due diligence was required to consider all good web archiving service vendor options, not just Archivit. So in summer 2014, a small group led by Abby Grotke from the Library of Congress, with representatives from several other member institutions, including myself, started working out the details for developing the proposal into a working initiative. The group developed a document outlining the potential benefits and risks of pursuing the proposal and some possible mitigations for those risks. The principal benefits that we identified were greater access to archive content, a more agile and sustainable process for selecting collection topics, greater opportunity to get more members involved and thereby depend less on individual institutions, and large potential for promotion and advocacy for the IPC and for web archiving in general, including through engaging more users through larger and more diverse global collections. So we've heard a little bit about this problem today. Different IPC member institutions operate in a wide variety of legal environments regarding web archiving. A small number of members are legally able in their countries to run full domain crawls and to provide public online access to the resulting content. But other libraries have legal deposit legislation allowing the full domain crawls, but not yet the right to provide public online access to the archive content other than on their own premises with outside owner permission. And some members, including all of us in the United States, lack explicit copyright exception provisions for web harvesting, and so are limited to creating either smaller collections with a permissions process and or to proceeding at our own risk, as the Internet Archive General Wayback Crawl has done with great success while they obey robots.txt restrictions and takedown requests. So the biggest benefit of this initiative from the IPC perspective, particularly from the people from the countries that don't have public access, was the promise of providing public access for content that members might individually be able to preserve but not make accessible. The most serious risks associated with the proposed initiative were legal, risks of bypassing legal deposit laws, the difficulty of determining legal responsibility in such cases, as the IPC is not itself a legal entity, and risk with the variety of legal requirements across many countries. The mitigations of these risks that we proposed were having a member institution step forward to assume responsibility in case of problems, also beginning with non-controversial topics or content, and also instituting a takedown policy similar to the Internet Archives if there are any issues. One possible mitigation, similar to what we do at Columbia, of securing permission from site owners for the joint collections was discussed, but it was decided against as it would nullify some of the key benefits of the proposal. I mean, it's a very time-consuming activity. Other risks included the sustainability of IPC funding for supporting the collection building and the long-term preservation of the collection. And there, the mitigations included careful consideration of all vendor options, making sure the chosen service provider has contractual obligations with regard to the preservation of content, and careful crawl budgeting so we don't waste what we purchase. Sustainability was often thought to be mitigated by members also taking their own preservation copies of collection, and the fact that shared ownership by all IPC members of the collections lessens their dependence on the circumstances of any single member institution. The risks that jointly created IPC collections could divert user attention from members' own collections, or that the joint collections would be duplicative of existing collections, were mitigated by the significantly increased public access to the content and the increased research value gained by broader perspectives within the collection. So the group also developed a working document on structure, governance, and workflows, and that proposed the creation of the IPC Content Development Group and laid out some of the roles that would be needed, such as co-leaders, a collection administrator, lead curators for each collection, and contributing curators. The steering committee asked Abby Grotke and I to be the initial co-leaders of the Content Development Group. During the late summer of 2014, the CDG identified some required features for the web archiving vendor service to be chosen, including the areas of tool administration, data capture, descriptive metadata, access, preservation, cost, and others. 9 tools and services were evaluated, and follow-up inquiries were sent to 3 service providers that had expressed interest in being considered for this gig. Archivit was the CDG's recommended choice, with the decisive factors being its more developed functionality for descriptive metadata, its use of common platforms, namely Heritrix and Wayback, and our assessment that though Archivit's upfront costs were higher, they were ultimately more sustainable because they're all-inclusive of harvesting, indexing, access, storage in perpetuity, and technical support. The steering committee approved the proposal to purchase a subscription to Archivit and to pay an added fee to transfer the 23 terabytes of legacy Olympics collections into Archivit. As the IPC is not itself a legal entity, the member institution serving as the IPC treasurer, the BNF, approved and signed the subscription contract, and so as of April 2015, the IPC has an Archivit account with a substantial crawl budget, 50 million documents, and 5 terabytes of data for the coming year. Currently, only the 2 2014 Olympics collections are publicly accessible in the IPC Archivit account. The Internet Archive is in the process of transferring the legacy Olympics data into respective collections for the 2010 Winter Olympics and the 2012 Summer and Paralympics, and the Content Development Group is reviewing what subset of the metadata provided those collections via the UNT nomination tool will be displayed in Archivit. Once the archive content and metadata is in place, the IPC will be able to publicize the collections, particularly as interest mounts around Rio 2016, the first Olympics in South America. Now, before Abby has a heart attack, I would say the CDG has not yet discussed any future Olympics collections. And luckily, though, the clock is already ticking on Rio 2016, as you can see, we would have time to plan for that as part of our next budget year, beginning in April 2016, if we chose to do so. When the collaborative collections proposal was raised at the Paris General Assembly last year, there was some brainstorming about other possible future collection topics, and certainly a desire to expand beyond just sports events. So the CDG subsequently created the collection policy, stressing collection topics of high interest to members, obviously, that don't, however, neatly map to any one member's responsibility or mandate, but instead gain research value from having the broader perspective possible for multi-institution collaborations. And the contours of that broader perspective were defined as transnational, but not necessarily global. Now, with the exception of the multinational scope, these same criteria might resonate with IBS Plus collaborative collection development decisions to come. The Rio 2016 Olympics will be the centennial of an Olympiad that wasn't. The 1916 Olympics were never held due to World War I. And as 2014 marked the beginning of the 4-year centennial of World War I, many memory institutions, including several IPC members, independently began web archives and other collections focused on the centenary commemoration. The BNF, the British Library, the Library of Congress, the National Library of Australia, and Library Archives Canada, among others, are all actively planning to archive web content about the World War I centenary, with some facing the access restrictions noted above, and none of them able to individually capture the worldwide scope of World War I, commemoration content on the web. So the CDG agreed that the benefits of increased public online access and the wider perspective of multi-institutional participation justified creating a collaborative collection that would overlap with existing member collections and even recapture some of the same seeds. Peter Sterling of the BNF and Sabine Schostag of NetArchive DK volunteered to serve as lead curators for the collection, and the CDG has begun to consolidate seed lists from these various efforts and has already received additional offers to contribute from the Deutsche Nationalbibliothek, Stanford University, and the Portuguese Web Archive. Members like Stanford or Columbia, who do not have a specific national mandate, but could instead contribute seed nominations from otherwise underrepresented areas, could help the IPC create collections that are not limited to content from just the nations of participating national libraries. Similarly, the existing Olympics collections, though large, are quite narrowly focused on the handful of nations whose libraries were involved. Anyway, we hope to be ready to crawl a large number of World War I websites in the early fall of 2015. So web content on World War I commemoration that's already been identified on these seed lists includes formal exhibitions produced by specialized museums and archives explicitly focused on the centenary, like some of these. Websites focused more narrowly on specific aspects of the war, such as the use of poison gas, or the farming work that was done by women while most men were at war. There are also extensive photo galleries of war graves, numerous regimental or local histories, newspaper articles, blogs, social media content such as Facebook groups or Pinterest pages, or Flickr galleries, all devoted to World War I topics. The heterogeneity of the content will require some careful consideration about cross-scoping and descriptive metadata. But some of the labor-intensive work of providing metadata or doing quality assessment of the captures can take place in the future, as long as we've captured the content while it still exists. The IPC mission statement connects web archiving to promoting global exchange and international relations. The Olympics and World War I collections tackle that theme from an event-based perspective, but it also occurred to us to take on the theme of international cooperation directly for a collection. The IPC is an organization devoted to international cooperation on the relatively narrow topic of web archiving, but there are thousands of other such organizations working on other issues, and a web archive of some of the most prominent international organizations could be a valuable resource. But where to start? One possibility that we hit on is the top-level domain .int, which is derived from international, and reserved for international treaty-based organizations, United Nations agencies, and organizations having observer status at the UN. Websites with .int almost all have information with intrinsic research value, yet there appear to be not many more than 100 active .int subdomains. Hopefully a useful future resource for researchers of international organizations, such as those studying and teaching in this building, Columbia School of International and Public Affairs, the .int websites provide a microcosm of the core topics of international relations: economic development, trade, humanitarian assistance, health, military alliances, peace building, human rights, law enforcement, environmental protection, climate change, and fishery management. Lots of fisheries. These agencies, charged with hashing out jurisdictions in the vast oceans, trying to sweep up millions of moving targets while negotiating legal restraints and conservation concerns, somewhat evoke to me the efforts of IPC members to figure out how to harvest the ocean of the web, though our motives do seem somewhat more altruistic and less profit motivated. At any rate, the IPC International Cooperation Organization collection has about 100 seed websites identified, and the advent of our Archivit account in April has given us the means to do some collaborative collecting. Those CDG members have all been busy with the IPC General Assembly at Stanford in late April and our institutional responsibilities and preparing for this gathering today. But some test crawls have been run, and now all that remains is to get started. So if you'll indulge me for a couple more minutes, I'd like to ask Abby Grotke, the co-chair of the Content Development Group, to come join me up here And while she does, we can take a look at our IPC Archivit interface. Welcome, Abby. I'll give you a chance to say what I left out in a second. So this is it. I'll take one step back. This is the collection as a whole. So you see all those other collections, the Olympics collections do exist. But we've done no new crawling except for test crawls within the International Cooperation Organization collection. So all the seeds are organized into two groups. This is a list of the larger one. You see that I threw netpreserve.org in there because I'm biased. But otherwise, these are the websites. They've all been put in here in advance. The only reason that eight of them are in a different group is just because these proved during test crawls to have higher data amounts, and it's going to be productive, I think, to crawl them separately with specific data limits. So that said, we're pretty much good to go, and I don't want to take much of your time. So as I said, I'll show you this one time is the group where most of the stuff it resides. So we'll go into modify crawl scope just to show you the crawl limits for the one-time crawls. So we have a 5 terabyte budget. We know the vast majority of it's going to be the World War I collection this year. We don't want to spend more than 1 terabyte on this collection, probably. And this is just the first crawl. There might be any kind of follow-up crawls. So I've limited it to the 0.5 terabyte and 4 million documents in 3 days. Probably will run out before then, in my experience. I think that's it. So one-time crawl. Make sure we click this one. Yeah. There we go.
All right, we're clicking together.
Yeah, I'll hold it.
All right.
Okay, good. 1, 2, 3.
Start.
Yes. All right. Crawl in progress. All right. So that's it. Yeah. Well, I was going to say that. So I think metaphors like ribbon cutting and groundbreaking are also 20th century. The 21st century, it should be starting the crawl. That's why you would describe beginning a new initiative. So I guess that questions. And then we have Abby up here. We should keep her up here in case there are more questions about the CDG or this effort. Yes.
Constituency or your like who you would see using this over the long run. Do you think of it the way that archivists would, that you know, you're looking to historians or genealogists or you know students or who? I mean, just how do you think about that, and how do you incorporate what you expect their interests would be into your decisions?
It's hard, but the CDG did think that would be a specific thing. So we will actually try to engage subject specialists and other users in the choice of future collection topics. You know, so but as far as the ones that we've chosen already, I think that with focusing on international organizations, we definitely have a lot of important resources there. But it's hard to say. Like, I can't answer that any better than other people today about you know. How is the stuff going to be used? But I think that use, although a very important reason to do this, is one of several. I mean, we have also outreach. We want to help promote the idea of web archiving, and it helps to have a shared collection that we can all point to. Even just for inside baseball, the web archiving stuff, having shared collections can help us troubleshoot. Like there's technical expertise scattered around the globe. If we have a particular collection that we all have access to and we could see a particular problem with certain crawl or certain CMS or something like that that's proving hard for Heritrix to deal with, it helps to have this collaborative collection thing. So I'm sorry, I don't know that much about users, so I can't answer that question very well. Ian maybe will answer some later in the day. Yeah.
I'm a historian, but I'm very much a novice, and there's a lot I don't know about what you do. But like, just to take an analogy, people have a lot of interest in time capsules, and it often generates a lot of enthusiasm. And, And yet, in all my life as an historian, I've never heard of any historian ever actually using a time capsule. But we use archives, you know. And I mean, so there are different logics and sort of different ways of thinking about why we do these things. And so I'm just, you know, I mean,
I think that point speaks to, so a lot of the distinctions in existing web archive collections is between event-based collections and ongoing thematic collections. So event-based collections are inherently time capsules because it was a moment in history. We got a bunch of information about it and that kind of thing. You can imagine people being interested in a particular event and going back to look at the context of that event. But at Columbia, with our human rights collection, for example, or hopefully for the international organizations collections here, the idea is to get the longitudinal stuff. So it's not just, you know, the time capsule, but it's like the archaeology. It's the whole, you know, depth. If you're capturing, you know, the WTO website, you know, in depth every year, you know, it helps. I hope. Yeah, Carrie?
Alex, so as I keep thinking about all these collaborations and the collaborative models, I keep going back to the who's talking to the creators. So the Vancouver, you know, Olympic records are at the city of Vancouver. So I was curious if that's where the work files came from the 2010, from the Winter Olympics, or is that, you didn't do the Winter, you did the Summer Olympics, the 2010?
I wasn't there, Abby might know more about, but I don't think we got things from content creators, right?
But I'm just thinking about, because the Olympics has an Olympic Studies Center, they do collect archives, they do stuff, so I'm just wondering of the, I think it's great that the IPC is doing this work, I just keep going back to the fact that we're doing this work, and yet how are we engaging or letting those creators know, hey, we're doing this, so one, don't put your own resources towards it, because we're already doing it, or we need resources to do this, so hey, content creators, give us the resources to do this type of work. And it's that collaboration that I keep kind of getting worried is, where are those discussions happening? I know they're really difficult to have often with those content creators, especially for large types of things, but I sort of feel like that's a really key player that I don't know that either we bring to the table or we're not at their own table anyway.
Yeah, I think I agree with you specifically about the Olympics because if we make the effort with the metadata for all these previous Olympics collections and we start publicizing them, you know, we have 2010 and 2012 and 2014, there becomes a certain expectation, well, why wouldn't you have 2016 and all that? But at the same time, why should it be our expense to always capture the Olympics for perpetuity? So why not contact the International Olympic Committee and see whether they can work with us on that? In a similar vein, the question came about United Nations content at the GA, and one suggestion was, well, UNESCO should be an IPC member. That would make it much easier if they joined, you know, and we crawled their stuff.
And I'm working with the UN archives too, so I was just thinking about that and like, okay, I need to talk with them then about also all the web archives that they've got, the websites they're doing as records, because I know they're engaged in thinking about that work as well, so that's a good thing to circle back around about.
Andrea?
I'm kind of curious about how many different IIPC institutions will be taking a copy for preservation. Have you started those conversations yet?
I think we talked about it during the what is this going to be part of the process, but we haven't really figured out what that will look like and how. Right, because IIPC is not an organization that could take a copy itself. So who would, I think it's part of the Archivit subscription that you could take copies, but we'd have to figure out, you know, who's going to step up and do that. And for it may be collection-based. It might be the curators that are stepping up to lead the collection effort might be the ones that want to take it in. There may be other, with around the legal issues, it's a little tricky because like LC, we can't host content that we haven't gotten all the right permissions for, so we could keep a dark archive for preservation, but maybe not make it accessible. So I think that's still to come. We have to figure that out.
Any other questions or time for lunch? Okay, we've got only 100 so far, but that's,
yeah.
All right. All right, we'll look into this. Okay. No. All right.
We'll probably check back during the day, and you can come back 3 days from now and see where it goes. Thank you very much for all the panelists. All right, and I will say, we think we're going to be talking a good deal more about collaboration towards the end of the day when we have open discussion, so I think there are a number of other questions that may come up there, but thank you. Lunch is in the back of the room. For those who want to stay here and talk to colleagues or check your email or write a new API for one of our, things, we have box lunches there. You're welcome to stay. There's some remains from breakfast and so forth. If you want to get out of the room for a while and go look around or anything like that, there are some restaurants on Amsterdam Avenue that are up and down from here, not too far away. I would suggest that you not go too far, because in just about an hour, we plan to have a few people who have volunteered to give very brief lightning talks on different topics of interest here. And then our formal sessions will reconvene at 2:00, so just keep that in mind. Thanks.